Hi, I'm Josh from AWS.
And I'm John from Innovative Solutions, and this is My Architecture.
So John, Innovative Solutions builds a variety of solutions as an AWS Premier Partner for a variety of customers looking to do things like adopt GenAI, as I understand it. Can you tell me a little bit about what you built here?
Absolutely. This is our architecture we call Tailwinds. Mm-hmm. We have two flows that come into Tailwinds. One is an indexing flow, and one is the front end of that indexing flow.
So to start with the indexing flow, I see some things like S3 buckets, I see DynamoDB. Can you tell me a little bit about how data actually gets into the architecture and why?
Data coming in here can be in any format. We can also take it in S3. We also have ways of taking it in through an API gateway. Once that data comes in, that's where it comes into this ETL here.
Okay, so the ETL is Lambda. Did you consider a service like AWS Glue when making that decision?
As a matter of fact, we do. We sometimes swap that out. It's kind of the overarching theme that you're going to see here is that this is a very customizable solution.
Yeah, I actually noticed you said like any type of data, right? Any type mm-hmm. of data format. How flexible is that S3 bucket icon there? How much can you flip?
Anything you can store in there, we can take in and start to read. And that's the beauty, really, of using services like Lambda and S3, is you can really customize it to your needs.
Okay. And then this is the indexing flow. Mm-hmm. So does it eventually come here to OpenSearch?
Absolutely. So once it comes out of this here, whether you're using Glue or Lambda, that's when we store it in the vector database. We've also used a graph database to do the same thing.
Okay. So the trade-offs of graph databases, vector databases, do you give customers that choice, or are you making that choice on the back end?
Both. We give the customers choice, but we also educate the customers on business cases and their use cases to help them pick the right service.
So we've got the data, we've got it sort of indexed, we have a lot of capabilities here now. So can you tell me about the consumer flow now, this
Absolutely.
API gateway?
So out here we have applications. We also have things like chatbots, like Lex or IBM X. All of those things come in and hit this API gateway here. So the API gateway is kind of the gatekeeper. That comes in and hits our Lambda processing here. When you heard me talk about a chatbot, we also have the ability to record a chat session or a chat state.
Okay, so you can provide sort of a chat interface that, mm-hmm. that stores that session,
yep.
and you're powering that by holding the session data in DynamoDB?
We certainly can, but chat is only really one piece of it. It's really meant to be almost the back-end processing. So from an application or from something other than a chat, basically mm-hmm. anything that can hit this API gateway.
So it sounds like there's a lot of flexibility in the types of applications that your customers can use to go through this flow. If we go here, so we have sort of the Lambda processing. Is this mm-hmm. the brains of the operation here? Is this orchestrating a lot of what we see over here?
Absolutely. So in this processing here, this is kind of where the magic happens. We can really program this to be very flexible and to do all kinds of things, like call out to a graph database or call out to another relational database to get mm-hmm. information in to add to that that motion of getting information from things like our vector database here. So all of that goes into this processing, and then that is what's getting sent over to our LLM.
So this Lambda can be highly customizable. You're doing things like semantic search, you're searching graph databases, you're customizing that to the needs of whatever this application is. Is that
exactly
right?
Okay. Exactly.
What were some of the trade-offs you made with choosing to do this inside this Lambda that's kind of orchestrating all of these complex tasks versus mm-hmm. some of the other decisions you could have made?
Absolutely. A lot of folks will look at this and say, hey, this looks a lot like knowledge bases. Mm-hmm. And in truth, it does a lot of the same things, but it's expanded. So knowledge bases are a great tool and they do some very good things. This gives you even more flexibility.
Yeah, so you had some really specific needs, it sounds like. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned knowledge bases. Mm-hmm. So let's go to Bedrock. With the model choices available in Bedrock, is that something where your customers can choose different models? Do you help them evaluate models? How do you handle that?
Yes. So along with this Tailwinds architecture, we do a lot of consulting. We do a lot of asking about business cases and business uses to help the customer understand what it is that they're choosing. So all of this choice, you have to pick the right thing for the right problem. And that's the same with Amazon Bedrock if we're looking at models.
So That's really cool. And one of the things that I think is most interesting is you're abstracting away a lot of the technical know-how, but customers get full autonomy over the business decisions. You know, they get to have so much flexibility in terms of, I want this kind of data, I want to use this kind of model. That's really cool. Mm-hmm. The challenge I see with that is, how can you have so much customization at scale with so many customers building all these different environments? How do you tackle that challenge?
I'm glad you asked. We do SAM and we do Terraform. So we do a lot of different ways of doing infrastructure as code. Mm-hmm. And as long as we can build it in infrastructure as code, it becomes very portable.
Yeah, so you're able to keep that flexibility, but also quickly deploy environments for customers?
Yes.
That's great. This is a really cool architecture, John. Thanks for sharing it with us.
You're quite welcome.